I think we're in for a very interesting session. We've got a number of papers that address the issue of religion and the diaspora. And I've just looked through the abstracts and noticed that we have interesting figures to actual people to focus on in the Greek American context. And the USA is of great, major significance with regard to the diaspora and religion. So we have the figures of Iakovos and Dimitrios in their different roles being presented by two speakers. We have another player who is the ecumenical patriarch, or patriarchate, and that again depends on the personality of the title holder and how leadership has been contested in some way in the recent period between the patriarchate in Istanbul and between that and Moscow. And the final sort of area in which we're going to be looking at this interplay is the European Union with its freedom of movement and different receiving countries, particularly Greece, Germany and the UK. So here we've got, I think we're going to hear about the contestation of core values and attitudes among the incoming Greeks and how they have to deal with that. So I want to hand over straight away. First person who's going to be speaking on this is Ioannis.
I'll be using the small microphone. So. Good afternoon. Let me start by first expressing my thanks to the organizers of this very interesting event. I will be talking about the ecumenical patriarchate as a diaspora actor, and this paper is based on my personal experience living in Turkey for the last years, but also my interest in studying religion and politics, both in the context of Turkey, but also in the Greek context. I think it's important to consider religion when we talk about the Greek diaspora, given the fact that religion has historically been a marker of Greek national identity in the Ottoman context as well. Let's not forget that population exchange between Greece and Turkey was made on the religion, not on the linguistic barrier. So. And what is also very interesting from that perspective is that as things evolved, the ecumenical patriarchate remained outside the Greek borders, which allowed it to remain beyond Greek nationalist definitions of identity. So in many ways, it has been able to develop a distinct role, and the confrontation between the Church of Greece and the patriarchate on a number of issues is very telling in that respect. And given the fact that the patriarchate has been organized in some parts of the world whereby the diaspora is particularly strong, this is North America, West Europe, Australia, its role has been very important. So I will begin with an overview of the situation of the patriarchate in Turkey, because it's important to understand the state of affairs within the country where the patriarchate is based, and then I will look into the ways the patriarchate has tried to collaborate with Greek foreign policy or SAE in the 90s and today, and how things can move forward. So, given the fact that language skills decline generation after generation, in many parts of the world, religion is the most important identity marker for Greek diaspora abroad. This is particularly the case in the United States, a country that has always puzzled social scientists because it defies the modernization thesis, whereby secularization and modernization come hand by hand. But in the United States, we have a country which is arguably one of the most advanced countries in the world, if not the most advanced, and yet religiosity is very strong. So religious communities are very important, and Greek diaspora communities are very important as well. Of course, one needs to consider that among all churches, it is the Orthodox Church that has been strongest affected by nationalism. So you may find Russian Orthodox dioceses or nation-defined Orthodox or mobilization organization around the world. This is a problem that the patriarchate has been facing in many countries in the world. But despite that, the patriarchate has been able to navigate through difficulties and reinforce its position in the latest years, I would argue that there were two figures that have been able to confirm this strong position of the patriarchy in diaspora politics. The first is Patriarch Athena Boros, who is really taking over the patriarchate in the aftermath of the Second World War. He comes from the United States himself, so he has an experience of the Greek-American community, and he is able to consolidate the position of the patriarchate in a very difficult context. Let's not forget that the patriarchate was allowed to remain in Turkey, but it faced a series of limitations and legal, institutional, and day-to-day obstacles by the Turkish state, which considered its activity to be against national security interests of Turkey. So this was the first step. The second step, of course, is coming with the end of the Cold War and the rise of Patriarch Bartholomew to the helm of the Patriarchate. Bartholomew has been a leader that has been considered one of the most cosmopolitan and sort of moderate figures of the Orthodox world, and he came to his position at a very fortunate moment. That was the time when the Cold War ended, and the opportunity of the Patriarchate to play a major role in Eastern Europe and territories whereby Orthodoxy was historically strong, this opportunity was bigger than ever. At the same time, the Patriarchate was engaging in activities of intercommunal and interreligious dialogue with actors in Turkey, Islamic actors beyond Turkey, with the Catholic Church, also engaged with issues like the environment, an issue that has ever since has become more and more important. And of course, a crucial issue has been the relations with the United States. This has been a difficult relationship in the last 20 to 25 years. And I refer, of course, to the succession of Archbishop Iakovos, who himself has been a very dominant figure in Greek diaspora affairs, and his succession by Spiridon, Archbishop Spiridon, met with the opposition of a significant part of the Greek-American diaspora, and this led to a clash with Archbishop, with the Patriarch Bartholomeus. Eventually, a new election was made, and Archbishop Dimitrios came to power, and however, as we now experience in the last years, things again are very problematic. So there is an issue to consider there, whether the institutional capacity of both the Archdiocese of North America and the Ecumenical Patriarchate, together with the non-religious associations of the United States, have been up to their mission to deliver transparency and efficiency when it comes to dealing with the church and diaspora affairs in the United States. The situation in Turkey, I alluded to in the beginning, has been rather difficult for decades. It's not only the long recognition of the ecumenical character of the Patriarchate. Historically, recognizing the Patriarchate as ecumenical has been considered to be giving base to allegations that a new Vatican would emerge within the territory of Istanbul. This may sound stupid and unbased to us, but there are thousands of Turks who buy this idea. So that was the reason why the courts and the Turkish government for many, many years refused to use the term ecumenical, relegating the patriarchate into the local minority church for Istanbul, Greece. Another critical issue has been removing the material base of the patriarchy, so properties around Istanbul, including religious buildings and real estate, was confiscated. This meant that the patriarchy did not have the capacity to support itself. And the same was the case with the numerous pious foundations of the Greek minority in Istanbul. So in many ways, the patriarchate became dependent on support from Greece and from the diaspora. So that was another important parameter that we need not to forget. Things have improved relatively in recent years, and this is not only related to the role of the ecumenical patriarch himself. The Greek minority in Istanbul, in Turkey in general, benefited from the first wave of democratization reforms back in the beginning of the AKP administration. So some assets were returned, including some very important buildings. And authorities, contact with authorities has become regular, at least more regular. So there's no taboo on the side of the Turkish state to meet representatives of the Patriarch. It was even a visit in the meeting about a month ago of the Patriarch to the Turkish president. And one of the issues that has been looming regarding the future of the Patriarchate itself, that means the citizenship requirement for potential patriarchs, so patriarchs have to be Turkish citizens in order to become eligible, has been for the time being resolved by giving Turkish citizenship to a number of bishops and priests within the Patriarchate and around the world. So there have been some improvements which have not, we've not witnessed a backslide yet. So while in other minority affairs or other human rights issues in Turkey, there is a backslide over the last years, there is no such backslide here, but there is no guarantee that this may not happen anytime soon. So the reform is not institution-driven, it's sort of personal. So it has some favors have been delivered, but we don't know when these favors may be sort of canceled. So, I highlighted how the end of the Cold War meant that the Patriarchate would develop its activities in Eastern Europe. This very often clashed with the interests of Russia and the Russian Patriarchate. I referred to the cases of Estonia or Ukraine being the most pronounced. In many cases, the Patriarchate worked hand in hand with SIAD, with the Council of Hellenes abroad. And I will refer briefly to a single, a very interesting case, the Gagauz minority of Moldova. The Gagauz is a Turkic Orthodox community that has been living in the south part of Moldova for many years. So while they are aware of their Turkic ethnic descent, they're also aware of their Orthodox religious identity. So this makes them eligible for membership on both the Turkish and the Greek diaspora sort of movement. And that was an interesting sort of detail in the whole initiative of SIAS. I attempted to develop links with these associations and make them part of the whole movement. I would like to conclude, since we don't have, our time is limited, we have time for discussion, that the Greek crisis has inevitably limited the capacity of the Greek state to support initiatives related to the Greek diaspora, and many of the joint projects between the Patriarchate and the Greek Foreign Ministry have suffered as a result of this. But there is an area whereby the Patriarchate could play a potentially important role, and that would be a suggestion that is linked to the case of the Halki Seminary. The Halki Seminary is one of the issues that has become a symbol of the oppression of the Greek minority in Turkey. It has been, I know personally, that it has been promised for several times that the issue would be resolved, and this started like years ago, and it was an issue that was always about to happen, but never happened. An interesting dimension of the Halki controversy has been the legal status of the school to be open, because the school used to be operating as a vocational school, not as a university. But now the Turkish law would allow the Halki Seminary to reopen as a private non-profit university, because Turkey now allows for such institutions. So this has been an interesting discussion in Turkey and within the Greek Orthodox minority, whether opening a university at Halki would be an interesting project, not for the Patriarchate only, but also for the Greek diaspora. So it's not only the clergy that can be educated there, but history can be taught, Byzantine history or conservation. Think of how important Istanbul can be for such activities. The Patriarchate has been reluctant, as far as I know, because they would be content with getting back what they used to have. But the issue has come back to the agenda. Given the fact that many of the historic buildings that the Greek minority used to possess in Istanbul have been returned, and because of the absence of the Greek population today, there is no proper use for them. I can refer to the orphanage building in Buyuka Dai in Pringipos, which is discussed to become an environmental center, but there are at least two buildings in Istanbul, one in Taksim, like the Kendrick Compartan over here, that has been recovered by the community, but there is no real use for this right now. So there have been discussions about opening like a Greek language center, cultural center, but these activities would require collaboration between the Greek diaspora, the patriarchate, and the Greek government. But of course, the Greek government involvement would bring all the risks maybe that the SAEF project has brought about. So I would highlight in my conclusion that the patriarchate's role as a diaspora actor remains very much dependent on the present and the future of the church in the United States. And given that this is an issue that is right now very sensitive, I think one needs to put all the most emphasis in finding a solution that would help the patriarchate maintain its role where it is, and also turn the Greek American diaspora into a support base for all sorts of activities in Turkey and beyond Turkey, wherever the ecumenical patriarchate is operating. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Yanni, for keeping the time so well. I'm sorry we have to cut off such interesting presentations.
Thank you very much for inviting me here. It is a great honor. And it's always a great honor to share with you some of the results of my research. And when I speak about Archbishop Iakovos, this is always a very controversial aspect and a topic, and I get very interesting questions. Now, this is because he was a very important figure, and as Alex has said in the past, maybe the most important figure of Greek America. I believe that he marked with his personal seal 37 years of tenure in the United States, and he managed with his very big personality to change the identity of the Greek America in his time. But since we speak about diaspora, I heard in, I think, the first panel that we have too many definitions about diaspora, and I will give you one more, because this definition is coming from the field of international relations. I have met so many definitions, and I can tell you that they are all very good, but there is space for improvement. And why do I say that? We have some definitions who are very huge. Gabriel Scheffer, for example, has given a definition which is a full paragraph, maybe 300 words. It's very big. Some other are giving definitions that they lack something, especially when it comes to our field, when we study diasporas from the political science perspective. So I came trying to make, I think, a complete definition, and I'm here to discuss it with all of you. I would call it an organized ethnic group that arose due to migration, either enforced or voluntary, lives out of the national borders, real or symbolic, and preserves active interest and involvement for the issues of the country of origin. And I say that because the most important thing we have to take in mind is that diaspora is a different thing than homogenia. I don't have another English word for homogenia, so I will use this in Greek, ergaomnes, which is very fashion lately. Diaspora has left the place of origin, the metropolitan center. Homogenia lives there. So the Greeks of Albania are not diaspora, they are homogenia. The Greeks of Istanbul are homogenia. This is how I see this from my science. Okay. And now, since the time is running very fast, the topic I am called to present before you is a comparative analysis of what Iakovos was doing for Greece and for the Greeks of Greece, in contrast to what he was doing for the Greeks of the United States, for the Greek American community of the United States. And it's a challenging topic because we come to face again what is the identity of the Greek American people. And the first thing we see, I think it was mentioned before, the different waves of immigrants. The first wave started in the late 19th century after the great and economically catastrophic crisis of raising in the area of North Peloponnese, the Corinth, because due to a European financial crisis, all the prices fell down, and then people started going out of Greece to the United States. That lasted until the early 20s, 1921, we had a new law voted by the Congress, and they imposed new quota. Am I right, Alex? They imposed some quota, and then many Greeks left outside. I have a family story to tell you about this. My great grandfather left from the island of Marmaras in Procondida. He flew to the United States, to Oregon, but my great grandmother stayed behind, and she had to suffer the Minor Asia catastrophe and then the persecution from the Turks. They went to Istanbul, and then they came down to what is today Oropos in North Attica. And they never met again until the late 60s, when my great-grandfather came back to Oropos to reunite, but they were too old. You know, so I have these memories and these stories in my family. The second wave was, of course, after the Second World War. But it was okay, I'll come to this again. The Second World War, people who have to, again, try to find refuge. It was, Greece was severely damaged. And they met with the first wave, which the first wave was going out of the proletarian state. They were, and together they went to the middle class. And from the middle class, through the whole Cold War, they went to the superior class. We have many millionaires and many billionaires today. We have a definitely good diaspora in social, educational, economic level, everything. And there's the third wave in the 80s, which is a very different diaspora. People with good education, people who have studied well in Europe, in Greece and Europe, and then they went to the United States bringing their human capital with them. This was a very different case. Maybe now this is interesting for the sociologist to discuss, or the anthropologist. If we have a fourth wave now, that's something we can discuss in a future conference maybe. But Iakovos happened to be the guy in the States during the second wave. So he had to manage people who have already come out of the proletarian state. And I say this word proletarian because this is the typology we have from a very important scholar, Armstrong. He was the first to give typology of diasporas. He says that we have two types, the proletarian and the mobilized man. Proletarians are poor, they have a strong cohesion as a group, they recognize each other, and they care too much about what happens in the metropolitan center. Whether it is imaginary, I mean, like the Jews before they had their own state, they had an imaginary land, an imaginary background, but they didn't have an actual state. Or if it is an actual state, just like all the European nation states we know today, and they have sent people to other continents. And the third thing is that the proletarians are very low class people. Usually they do all the jobs that the locals don't want to do. And the opposite happens to the mobilized diasporas. They are stronger, they have integrated well, they have penetrated the social system of the country that has accepted them. But on the other side, they lack cohesion. They start now becoming, let's say, Americans, but of Greek descent. And Iakovos met these waves. He didn't have much to do to help them. He didn't have to lobby to the American political system for issues that had to do with the Greek Americans, because they were already well established. Allow me to remind you that in the 70s they had a vice president, Spiro Agnew. He was vice president of the United States. And they had also people who were members of Congress, like Sarbanes. They had people who were businessmen. They had people who were elected in state councils or in even city and local councils. But what Iakovos thought it would be very interesting was to enhance the role of his church and together with the church, also the community. Because one very important thing, an identity issue for the Greeks is, as we have seen, the church. The community was built around the church. So it's something that doesn't have to do only with the metaphysical concerns of the Greeks. It doesn't mean that if you go to the church, you take the letter of the gospel. It's something that has to do with your socialization when you go abroad. Even we, I judge from myself, when I go to the States, I will definitely go to the church on Sunday because I want to see the people and socialize with them. Now, let me tell you something. The three cases, I will come to them fast because I don't know, are we on time? 5 minutes, okay. This is something that we have to acknowledge when we discuss about the Acropolis. In 1964, the clergy lady of Denver, he went there, he was elected in 1959 Archbishop of America. And he was elected with a very significant letter. There is in the document I have submitted to you for the conference. There was a letter by Prime Minister Karamanlis in 1959 to the Ecumenical Patriarch, to Athenagoras, and said, Karamanlis knew that the Holy Synod was ready to elect someone else from New York. But he wanted Iakovos because he knew him. He knew that he had the potential to serve political purposes. So he wrote a very straight letter to Athenagoras and said that the government of Greece wishes you to send to America not the person, the metropolitan that you have already selected, but Iakovos, because he is the guy who can fulfill special national interests. So keep it in mind, it's very important. That's the first document we have. The second document is this one. He addressed the clergy lady. Okay, where in 1964, 5 years after he came to the States, again, because he was also a deacon of Athenagoras 20 years before. He says, our church must remove itself from the sidelines and place itself fully in the center of American life. It must labor and struggle to develop its spiritual life and thus assume its place among the other churches as a living, thriving, and courageous, as Zosa, Drosa, Tharalea, it's very important, as he said it in Greek, ready to accept responsibilities and eager to submit to sacrifice, and now, this is the best part according to me, becoming one of the strongest and largest American churches. What he said was, for the first time, I haven't heard it from people in Greece, let's become the champions in the United States. Let's become great. Let's not be poor immigrants or people hidden in ghettos, but let's become Americans and good Americans. So the next year, in 1965, he did what? He took a plane, he went to Selma, Alabama, and he walked abreast Martin Luther King, showing that the Greek Orthodox Church, and of course the Greek community of the United States, had the capacity to accommodate such a struggle as the human rights, the civil rights, and the fight that the African Americans were giving. And then he was photographed by Life. He was on the cover of Life of March 1965. So imagine an Orthodox priest. How strange can it be for the American audience? They've never seen an Orthodox. They didn't even know that there was an Orthodox religion. The protocols didn't recognize it. In the Vietnam War, the Greek Orthodox soldiers were being buried like Protestants of other Christian faiths. And Michael and then his successor, Iakovos, they made Orthodoxy the fourth major faith in the United States. So there was some big issue. So given this, he tried to lobby the American establishment. 2 minutes? Okay. For what? I'm going back to the previous slide. Well, civil rights movement, that's the first thing he contributed for the Greek Americans. The second was promote Greek education, but not necessarily with I put this in brackets, in a nationalist way. He didn't hesitate to propose the English language in the liturgy because he saw that younger generations were not so comfortable with Greek. And maybe that should be a reform. At that time, Athenagoras and other people, conservative circles in the United States, they thought that it was an act of treason, and they stopped him. But with his own rhythm, he managed to let English gradually come in because he could see mixed marriages and other things that would let the Greek community and the Greek Orthodox people lose other people from around. And the last thing that I would like to mention is the Greek National Day, which happened quite late, in 1987. But together with some Greek Americans, one of them was Andy Athens, it was mentioned before. Andy Athens was one of his best friends. He was a billionaire. He had a big corporation of metal and things like this in the Midwest. And he was based in Chicago. So together they lobbied and they managed to have an official proclamation by President Bush that made it was Reagan, and they managed to have together a proclamation that made the 25th of March a national day of the United States and the symbol of Greek American friendship. But what did he do for the national issues? He was involved. 1 minute. Okay. He was very much into politics. If I can use this expression, if he wasn't an archbishop, he would definitely have been a politician, a minister, or something like this. And he was very much in favor of justice, as he could see it from his side as a Greek. And he did too much. He helped the Greek American lobby, all the initiatives. Andy Athens established with his encouragement the UHAC, United Hellenic American Council, in 1974, together with the AHI and AHEPA. They did together this rule of law campaign in the Congress that imposed an embargo on arms sales to Turkey. The conflict in the Aegean in the 80s, we have two initiatives. The first thing is that he tries to consult Andreas Papandreou, who was hostile to him initially, about how to handle the Aegean issues. And on the same time, he has what we say in IR, the reverse influence phenomenon, to try to tell him not to be so anti-American, because this is not to the best interest of Greece. And he did it. He helped him change. And the last thing, which is also contemporary, is the name issue of Macedonia, but also the essence of Macedonia, because this has to do with Cold War and with the Balkans. And Iakovos, not only he was supporting in the 90s the maximalist view on the Macedonian name issue, but throughout the Cold War, for 30 years, he was monitoring very closely the Slav Macedonian organizations and the Macedonian Church, which was established in North America. And he was reporting to the Greek authorities and to other colleagues in the diaspora. One conclusion, as I said before, the church is the nucleus of community life. That's why it has inspired so much interest around it. An established diaspora didn't need much from Iakovos to help them integrate like other proletarian diaspora, like the Latinos, etc. And last, he was in favor of the Greek position, so he tried to help as much as he could the Greek agenda towards the United States. And he had very good personal relations with all his contemporary presidents. Thank you very much, and sorry for taking that time. Yeah.
On April 16, 2007, Gas Bilirakis, a Republican congressman from Florida, rose in U.S. House of Representatives to pay tribute to AHEPA, the American Hellenic Progressive Association, on its 85th anniversary. Bilirakis was speaking as the co-chair of the Congressional Caucus on Hellenic Affairs. The Hellenic Caucus is a bipartisan group concerned members of Congress working to foster and improve relations between the United States and Greece and Cyprus. And it's got about 125 members. So it's just very few Greek Americans and many others. Bilirakis, in his speech, promised that the caucus would, and I quote, work in conjunction with AHEPA to continue to strengthen US-Greek relations and to secure, quote, religious freedom and protection for the ecumenical patriarchate. And he added, quote, "That is our number one issue, Mr. Speaker." He then added the caucus would also work towards promoting peace in Cyprus and resolving the firearm issue. The prioritization of the protection of the ecumenical patriarchate over the other issues was and is still a new departure in the language and policies of the Washington-based Greek lobbying organizations. And it's not a coincidence that the Hellenic Caucus was formed in 1996, the year Archbishop Iakovos stepped down because of pressure from the ecumenical patriarchate, a development that illustrated the increasing role the patriarchate began to play in the affairs of the Greek-American community. What I'll be talking to you about is really two interests of mine, the relationship between Greek-American ethnicity and religion and the church, and the history and activities of the Greek lobby. It is framed by my strong sense of the correlation between ethnicity and religion that's already been mentioned several times today, and also in terms of lobbying, the fact that the Greek-American lobby is still considered to be very strong and important, even though arguably the real success was the Turkish arms embargo of 1974-76. The paper examines both ethnicity and religion in Greek-American lobby in the present era, and I just completed a book manuscript on the history of the Greek Orthodox Archdiocese, ending in 1999. What I'll be doing now is I'm talking about current affairs, the Dimitrios era, from 1999 to the present. So you're listening to a historian commenting about current events, so take it any way you like. This is what I see as a trend, the increasing significance of religion as a form or of the way Greek identity is understood by the Greek Americans. There's an increasing prominence of Orthodox issues and an increasing way in which Orthodoxy is the lens through which they see Greece. The Orthodox charities arguably were the most effective in helping Greece during the previous years during the crisis. And as a background to the increasing understanding of Orthodoxy as important, we also have the increase and influence of the ecumenical patriarchate in the affairs of the archdiocese. Another way of describing what the US Greek American community is going through after 1999 is to describe the current era not as the Dimitrios era, but as the post-Iakovian era. That era was a time when the Archbishop functioned as an ethnarch, acted as an intermediary between Washington, D.C. and Athens and Nicosia, retained significantly a degree of autonomy from the ecumenical patriarchate. This came to an end when Iakovos decided to push that autonomy a little bit too far and participated in a very important conference that took place in 1994, known as the Ligonier Conference. Ligonier is a town in western Pennsylvania where the Antiochian Orthodox Church has a retreat. And there the American Orthodox churches got together and made a first step towards creating an autonomous American church. The reaction of the ecumenical patriarchate was direct and uncompromising. It blocked the process, it forced the Iakovos' resignation, it broke up the archdiocese of North and South America into one, the archdiocese of South America, Central America, America, which is the United States, and one in Canada. It restructured the Holy Synod, weakening the powers of the archbishop and making its presence much more felt. The person chosen to lead the archdiocese after three turbulent years under Archbishop Spirivan was Dimitrios, a cerebral, soft-spoken theologian with more experience with teaching at Harvard Divinity School rather than leading a major organization with 540 parishes, 800 priests, approximately 1.5 million faithful, and an annual budget of upwards of $22 million. No one could confuse Dimitrios with the dynamic, beloved, respected, and feared Archbishop Iakovos. Yet the gentle and wise Dimitrios extraordinarily proved himself to be the right person for the right job, and soon calmed the troubled waters that were roiling the church in the immediate aftermath of Iakovos' resignation. And for many second and third generation Greek Americans, the closer connection with the ecumenical patriarchate was considered a plus. Among them, prominent Greek Americans. One of them was the late Michael Chaharis, a significant backer of the Greek Orthodox Archdiocese, who at a speech he made in 2012 wondered whether the Greek Americans should intervene and help out if Greece, because of the crisis, could not continue to help and support the ecumenical patriarchate. Thus, Dimitrios was able to consolidate his presence as archbishop. Ironically, the upheavals caused by the immediate demise of Iakovos gave pause to people who were dissatisfied with Dimitrios, because there is an opposition to Dimitrios, which is now growing. More about that a little bit later. The diminished powers of the archbishop seemed not to prevent the increase in the numbers of Greek Americans who defined their identity in terms of religion. Here I've got some facts and figures that may just illustrate what's going on. Between 2008 and 2011, out of the roughly 1.4 million persons who report Greek heritage at the US censuses, 87% were born in the United States, and most of them are naturalized, and of those who were born outside, most of them are naturalized Americans. These are historically very high figures. We should note that the figures for New York City are much different. New York City is an anomaly. They're mostly Greek-born Greeks, and that's where the opposition to Dimitrios is taking place, because most people resent the involvement of the ecumenical patriarchate. But these are the Greek-born Greeks in New York City who control a great deal of the Greek-American media. Another study published in the Journal of Hellenic Diaspora in 2012 reports that 85% of second and second generation Americans say they attend church regularly, and 83% of third generation report that. They seem very high figures to me, but it gives you an indication of the sentiment and the way people want to represent themselves in survey. Very high numbers celebrate Greek Orthodox holy days. Relatively few express a direct interest in Greece or following events in Greece. So there's those figures give you a sense that how identity is veering towards Orthodox symbols rather than the old connection with the homeland. The Greek American lobbying activities reflect these trends. I already mentioned the Hellenic Caucus and the priority of supporting the ecumenical patriarchate. And significantly, the three Greek American congressmen that we have, Gaspilirakis, John Sarbanes of Maryland, and Dina Titus of Nevada, I may be forgetting one, are all third generation Greek Americans. So for them, the religious dimension would come very, very easy. There are other signs. There's an organization called the Coordinated Effort of Hellenes, established by the lobbying firm of Manatos and Manatos. Their main activity is, one of their main activities, is an annual event that they describe as the, quote, annual Cyprus, Hellenic and Orthodox Issues Conference, close quotation. This is the first time that Orthodox issues receive equal billing with those of Cyprus and Hellenes. When in 2009 this organization decided to confer a special award to then Secretary of State Hillary Clinton, it invited Archbishop Dimitrios to make the presentation. finally, AHEPA, the largest Greek American organization, has got the same attitude towards the ecumenical patriarchate. It proudly announced in 2004 that a delegation was invited to Istanbul, Constantinople, they said, on the occasion of Pope Francis's visit there. Quote, the delegation attended Divine Liturgy, where Ecumenical Patriarch Bartholomew and Pope Francis delivered official remarks. Also on that day, the delegation attended a concert of the Archdiocesan Byzantine Choir and a dinner with His Eminence Archbishop Dimitrios and the Order of St. Andrew of the Apostle, which is an organization run by the Archdiocese. On November 29, the AHEPA delegation attended a dinner in honor of the Ecumenical Patriarchate Bartholomew. Where does this, what is this pointing to? And this is a working hypothesis, of course. Is the post-Jacobian era one in which we have a relatively smaller archdiocese, which retains nonetheless its hegemony over Greek American life? We also have a weaker archbishop, but we steadily have an increasing pro-Orthodox sentiment among Greek Americans. And what does that mean? Did the ecumenical patriarchate's moves from 1996 onwards not only prevent that emergence of an autonomous American Orthodox Church, but also, in a sense, help its own cause and solidify its influence over the Greek American community? Initially, we could answer in the affirmative, but we also have to take into account the fluidity of the relationship between ethnicity and religion. Both are very vague and notions that have many interpretations. Therefore, we do have sections of the Greek Americans who feel just as strongly about their religion, but not as strongly about the ecumenical patriarchate. There is a growing number of Greek Orthodox in the United States who formed the organization Orthodox Christian Laity in 1988 to pave the way for the creation of an American Orthodox Church. They wish to go even further than Iacobus was considering in 1994. Their goals are to create a consensus among Orthodox Christians in North America, hierarchs, clergy, and laity, that it is urgent to establish an administratively united Orthodox Church in North America that is autocephalous. Finally, I conclude by making reference to what Yannis said about the current situation. There has the aid, which you've heard about, and I know, was that a stomach? it's what you have been reading in the news about, which is the financial scandal issues that are associated with the very ambitious project of rebuilding the Church of St. Nicholas, a small Greek Orthodox church, which was actually, ironically, old calendarist once upon a time, but that's another story. But it was destroyed when the Twin Towers collapsed at 9/11. And after Herculean efforts, the Archdiocese decided that it would get permission from New York State to rebuild it and not have it as a Greek Orthodox church, but as a non-denominational inter-whatever faith shrine, which is, of course, a comment on where Orthodoxy may be going in the United States. And it was a very ambitious project. It's been half built, and now we have the construction firm pulled out, the architects pulled out. There's chaos, and the archbishop is being, people are asking for the resignation of the archbishop. So both the OCL, the rise of the OCL, and the archbishop show us that the post-Jacobian era, which we thought momentarily was under control thanks to Dimitrios, is nonetheless very unstable at the moment, and I wouldn't be able to bet where Greek Orthodoxy will go in one direction or another. So I'm going to make an awful connection. The way some people say, oh dear, wasn't it good at during the Cold War because at least things were stable? Wasn't it good during the Jacobian era? Things were stable.
What I wish to talk about today is an unfinished business, actually. It's Greece's Europeanization and indirectly the role of the neo-migrants therein. Now, Greece has suffered, as you know, a prolonged economic crisis in which literature as of late is rife with analysis on the causes. And one could expand on the Eurozone structural deficiencies, emphasize the punitive attitude of the Troika, debate on the apportioning of accountability, and so on and so forth. Yet, decades-long domestic, endemic, structural and political cultural weaknesses have an immense causal bearing on Greece's predicament. Those can, in passing, be summed up to clientelism, corruption, populism, you know, the old structural shortcomings of the state apparatus, even the private sector developed unhealthy ties with the latter. In addition, Greece has a poor record of reforms, and that, in retrospect, seem all the more imperative. In an array of sectors, such as labor market, social security, public health, etc., reforms have either failed or were not adequate, which attests to the problematic modernization of the state. To make things worse, apart from the low competitiveness, the Greek economy cannot find ways to absorb and utilize the wealth of domestic human capital to its benefit. A significant number of highly skilled and or well-educated professionals, in light of the poor prospects in the above economic climate, choose to migrate to Greece's detriment. Greece has a history of emigration, skilled or unskilled. Contrary to the European core states, Greece, like other peripheral countries, experiences a surplus of skilled labor, not necessarily because it is really excessive, but rather because the economy is not in a position to profit from its human capital. Given that the likelihood of repatriation is very small, it would be more realistic for the end goal to be able to benefit from emigration as a means towards transferring better practices and attitudes from the West. Thereby a shift in the overarching socio-cultural mentality and attitude to production, consumption, work ethic, relationship and interaction with the state and its structures may transpire. Ultimately, an infusion of the domestic value system with elements taken from more successful socio-economic cultural paradigms, devoid of the euphemistically called Greek reality, ελληνική πραγματικότητα, of the endemic flaws built in the Greek self-image, which are often perceived as part of the Greek particularity. Now, Tunis defines community, Gemeinschaft, as a form of social organization permeated by the organic development of relationships and associations, whereas the Gesellschaft, society, as an ideational, rational one. The former is emotional, personal, traditionally structured, while the latter is rather impersonal and efficiency-driven. In the case of Greece, distinct patterns of social organization show that the transition from community to society has been partial and problematic, and that constellations of the Gemeinschaft typology are still commonplace. Greece missed the wave of intense urbanization of the second half of the 19th century. Notably, even in Europe, the social differentiation between the late 19th century city and its early modernity predecessor was immense, as the previous social stratification model was made obsolete. Urbanization gave rise to commercialization and a new typology of professions and entrepreneurship, e.g. the developer, the realtor, and to new living conditions which, with regard to owning and renting property. Within the framework of the discourses of the time concerning urbanity, the view of the city as modern and as the setting where modernity was realized, political and cultural progress and creativity were identified with urbanity. Moreover, in the industrialization of the 19th century, one detects emergent patterns of pan-European intertwining and integration of production and markets with the involvement of governments, while the cultural homogeneity simplified the technical and scientific changes. Not to mention that the second industrial revolution of the late 19th century enabled the full mechanization and the paradigm shift in the means of production from the pre-industrial model, consequently the corresponding transition in the professional social typology. Instead of attributing all the Greek deficiencies to historical materialism, not only Greek deficiencies, but the differences between the Greek and the European paradigm to historical materialism or rationalism, Max Weber considers it an outcome of a religious historical process that was ushered in by the Reformation. In that sense, even in overwhelmingly Roman Catholic countries, for instance, one observes a predominantly backward, traditional work ethic and a capitalistic underdevelopment. It is a pre-capitalist human natural impulse to reproduce and perpetuate a given way of life and to resist innovation. The spirit of capitalism, in short, thrives in the individualist environment of the Gesellschaft, not in a collectivist Gemeinschaft, for it is the exercise of the individual's calling that is prioritized as the highest form of this worldly activity. While the individualist culture within society provides an environment in which personal norms, goals, and aspirations are given priority, in collectivist community cultures, group norms are and aspirations come first, thereby duties and pre-specified roles are more or less a given. One is not one's own, but a group member primarily, and it follows that the individual yields to the community, as Hirschhorn writes. In turn, this affects the state, its structures, institutions, and functions. Greece has not fully transitioned from the Weberian patrimonial state to the modern one, as the latter is impersonal, whereas the former favors personal relationship. Greece's main pillar of social organization is that of kinship. In fact, it co-determined its urbanization as the Gemeinschaft, with its pre-existing familiarity networks, was transferred to the city, forming thus the urban village, particularly in the absence of any bourgeois or proletariat class in the urban setting. The familial kinship typology of group adherence complicates the interaction with state institutions, as it renders it superficial, non-participatory, and the citizen unaccountable. In any case, the Greek state building was modeled after the Western paradigm, but it was imposed on an Oriental society, and it would not be amiss to hold that Greece's Europeanization was the first experiment of that kind. However difficult the task, between 1833 and 1835, ministries, administrative bodies, courts, communal law, the administrative division of the country to nomi, provinces, comprised the foundations of a Greek state. Today, cross-party political elites who have served from high-ranking posts admit that Greece needs to catch up with the European core states and meet the EU standards, ultimately within the Europeanization framework, to appropriate and embed the so-called good practices that other states adopted organically in the lapse of time. What is more, Greece will need to accomplish that within a compressed time frame. A latent identity crisis surfaces in the shape of Eastern inclination and anti-Westernism, which has contributed to the selective and partial application of the necessary reforms. After all, Europeanization boils down to the implicit convergence of cultures that certainly affect the ways of doing things, not to mention shared beliefs that cannot be devoid of principles. Overall, there can be no such convergence without any reference to ethos, and the newly emigrated Greece, the EU states worth of freedom of movement, establishment and employment applies, may serve as a conveyor of good practices in Europeanization, regardless of how many of them choose to repatriate. Empirical evidence so far suggests that whilst abroad, many seek to be embedded in a social support system, and they find it in the existing diasporic formations, which are pervaded by the same basic elements that constitute a sense of belonging. A most popular refuge as such would be the Greek Orthodox Church and its corresponding migrant communities, the Greek Orthodox religionscapes. These religionscapes are coterminous with the already established migrant communities because for the most part they emerged out of the need for a constant, stable point of reference, as their presence in their host countries was not safeguarded as it is today by the EU acquis. The post-2009 wave of Greek emigration found the religious capes that were formed during the 50s and 60s either as gastarbeiter, guest workers, or post-colonial Commonwealth citizens. This is not surprising given that Greeks tend to establish their church together with their communities. The Greek Orthodox metropolis of Germany and Exarchate of Central Europe, for example, was founded on February 5, 1963, long before the Greek gastarbeiter secured the right to remain in the country. Likewise, the Archdiocese of Thyatira in Great Britain, founded in 1922, clearly preceded the establishment of the Greek Cypriot Commonwealth migrant communities. This typology is not alien to the Greek government's General Secretariat for Greeks Abroad, which considers the Greek Orthodox Church significant appeal to newly arrived emigrants. However, the transformative element is a given when identity fermentations transpire within religious scapes. It appears that such de- and re-territorialized religio-cultural constellations, particularly when well established, are infused with elements of the host country and undergo a form of cultural mutation or hybridization as they crystallize in local clusters within the context of globality. Therein, a new constantly under construction collective and individual memory is being forged into the narrative of a living community. Within the context of deterritorialized, mutated communities, one may draw parallels between the present and past examples in order to better understand and appreciate what this population movement and religious scape formation may yield. The Greek Enlightenment is such a case, where a series of geographical points of reference, Bucharest, Jassy, Budapest, including the Balkan diaspora in Transylvania, Venice, Trieste, Vienna, etc., extended outside the classical heartland of Greece, well into Central Europe, rather expectedly as the incoming Enlightenment ideas emanated from the West, wherefrom several bright individual scholars, intellectuals, tradesmen emerged. Adamatos Korais, whose note on the current condition of the Greeks, για την παρούσα κατάσταση των Ελλήνων, first published in French in 1803 and then repeatedly in Greek, produced the definitive work of the Greek Enlightenment. He in particular insisted in the transfusion, the metakenosis, of the Western system of ideas and values to Greece following centuries of cultural distortion. In short, from within the Greek diaspora emerged the Greek national movement. It advocated national regeneration through education and the subsequent formation of nationhood as a preparatory step towards statehood. This was a mindset obviously modeled after the Western paradigm to which the Greek Orthodox diaspora was exposed. Intended to reintegrate the Greeks to the European family of nations, of course. The Greek state and society should not expect its emigrant brains to yield the benefits immediately, as they're not going to return, as we said earlier. This will take time, as most sociocultural fermentations do. There is a proven tendency for Greek emigrants to seek an existing network of established Greek communities, as we said earlier again, which, more often than not, are to be found in religious scape formations. The latter have already collectively undergone the processes that determine their integration in the host country and enable their hybridization. They did not lose their identity, I must note, but infused it with new elements that rendered them integration-able in the first place. Their adaptation may be proven useful to the new emigrants and constitute a stepping stone in the context of an old-new diaspora discourse, which will serve as a learning process within a compressed time frame. The new diaspora, in turn, should not be expected to sever its ties with the homeland. It may well function as conveyor of value systems, know-how, insights, and ultimately of convergence with more successful paradigms. In that sense, a most valuable aspect of human capital, the brains and psyches, that is actually transferable despite the distance, particularly nowadays, may be in a constant engagement with the homeland, being in fact enriched via the migratory experience. As such, a postmodern metakenosis cannot be excluded. Thank you for your attention.